Mini chapter 99, Jaymi test drives Scorpio. Motionless in his chair, Jaymi flicks his eyes to the bottom right corner of his screen to check the time, then glances around his bow-windowed eyrie. At 6 o'clock, Herb and Ashley will be arriving at the house on Electra Drive. He has also instructed all 5 incarnated beasts to gather this evening in the guest wing there, ready to be summoned upstairs to the study as soon as Herb is ready to drop them into the new West Side environment for their mission. But meanwhile, this final beast's creation cycle is barreling forward. For now, it is time to test drive Scorpio, prior to incarnating him in all his sexy little fierceness into the big bad world. Oh, it's dirty work this, but someone has to do it. So, out Scorpio slinks into a test street on Jaymi's laptop, holding a saucer containing 4 large snails that he's just picked off a pot plant at home, where he'd discovered them hiding in its leaves. The snails are climbing all over one another, straining their horns and necks up in all directions, hungry for scents, sights, and other information about this new street environment. He turns right, seeking vegetation in which to deposit them. The saucer is now dripping with snails, and he's at an increasing loss to know what to do with it. He stands there, anguished under the lamplight, while the flesh of his test body streams with uncontrollable trickles of fresh perspiration, as it always does so infuriatingly soon after he's just showered, whatever the temperature may be. And what the fuck is he going to do with this snail-dripping saucer? He can't leave it on the pavement, because the snails would slither away and get stepped on. While he dithers, he's approached by a young man who's been lurking nearby in the manner of a street dealer. "Hey girl, you all right?" he says, peering at Scorpio and the saucer of frisking snails, while continuing to keep a wily eye around him. Could it be a subtle come-on, wonders Scorpio. The man is in his late 20s, perhaps Bangladeshi, and swaggeringly attractive, but Scorpio is still distracted by his snail mission, so makes some indistinct reply, then carries on up the pavement, half glancing behind him from time to time, half hoping to be grabbed by the waist and swept away into the shadows, but the man is not following him. At last he finds a tree with some undergrowth around it. As soon as he's tucked the saucer beneath the leaves, however, he glances around what has clearly become a nighttime street full of death, for he can now see evil approaching down the block. A 3-wheeled coffin rolls towards him, with vultures on top of it and egg-shaped wheels. On posts around the coffin, small clear plastic bags are nailed, with a fruit bat in each close-fitting bag, unharmed but wriggling. He shivers to see that within the open coffin is a supine figure, unmoving until the vehicle draws level, whereupon the figure tilts its head up and its eyes flash red. It extends a hand that's shuffling a tarot pack, where grotesque clown faces push out of the blur and whir of cards to bite up into the air and snap at Scorpio. He jumps as a shadowy ambulance streaks past, hissing off ahead towards a hill that's topped by a giant Ferris wheel sprouting spikes around its circumference. Beneath the wheel stands a giant hand made of shadow, menacing. Its fingers are curled down, except for the middle one, which beckons at Scorpio. Tall figures flank the hand, bending their will at him in silence to trap him. He feels his feet drawn in their direction, then sets off at a run to hide. A woman's head peers down from an attic casement at the end of a row of terraced houses on this block, which rear up in giddy shapes with a kind of fisheye lens effect, so the casement and her head start out at him in shocking prominence. The night sky is yellow, the house is red, and the garden's an ill green. Around the side of the woman's house, fearful faces peer out of windows into a dim courtyard where drips fall through spotlit steam. The face of Mr. Punch pokes through a window crack, and something scuttles in the shadows at the courtyard's far end. He slips through a door into a hallway to find Punch now sitting inside a windowed box, eyeing Scorpio sharply. Blood is spilling through the ceiling in quantities that increase in tandem with the anguish arising in Scorpio at his own fear of light bulbs falling out. "Why is there blood pouring through the ceiling?" he asks the figure in the box. "Nothing to do with me," squawks Punch, "because I live at an 80-degree angle," and convulses in manic laughter. On the staircase ahead, one rabbit is stroking a second rabbit, with paw movements that are fully as knowing as those of a human hand. Above them is a girl of about 10, who shrieks in fear and horror at Scorpio's approach. He freezes, not knowing whether to turn tail, to stay still, to dash past her as fast as possible, or, perhaps the least promising option, to act natural and try sneaking past her unnoticed. Yet before he can stop himself, he has chosen none of these, but instead rushes straight at her, contorting his face so as to cause maximum revulsion between them both, leaping up, up and over her head with sudden superhuman buoyancy, leaving her crying far beneath. Streaming sweat and shuddering, he lands, as if into a new state of knowing. He is startled to spot Jaymi applauding up in the world above the laptop screen. "Congratulations, my little Scorpio. You can handle anything," Jaymi enthuses. "And oh boy, you are ready for your incarnation." Scorpio blinks in confusion, then smoulders ironically up at his creator, and then looks apprehensive. "If you say so," he replies. "I hope this incarnation business is all it's cracked up to be." "Yours in particular will be exhaustingly electrified," says Jaymi, "but exhilarating as fuck, so buckle up."